So now we will hear from two phenotyping facilities. One that is being building up and another that has been doing a lot of phenotyping that are Nordic universities and very important such. But actually not part of the core of NordPlant. So first is Stefan Jansson. He's going to talk about the Umeå science centers that work around.
This is where I was yesterday. Because then you
because light costs are much less than heating costs now. So this is all LED lit and with no outside. And then you get other challenges with LEDs. We still struggle a little bit with red to far red ranges. The trees look a bit different because of this. But it's, so it's, just, so it's a closed system. And now, just make a movie if I need to show you. So, because it's all, I mean, at least at this stage, we're only working with different transiendings where the candidate genes are up or down regulated. And we do the generation of transiendic genes in pretty large scale at Umeå. Well, that was really there when they started them. And very much that the techniques are the same. You're using stem segments, that is incubated under bacterium, and then you propagate them, and if you do this in a good way, we have quite a good facility. I would say we have more than 3 or 4 full-time positions only doing this, taking care of the trees and the in different yards. And 6 or 8 months later, you will have a small tree like that that you can start putting into the feed facility. And so it costs like anyone else, you put them there and you water them automatically as they go around. And so I guess everyone who started this up, you know, there are a lot of issues in the beginning. Things get stuck in the processes, so they have been, but slowly, slowly we're getting there. So now, those who can have the 1,000 lead experiments going. And as I said, the main phenotype here is growth. So that means that it's a lot of how to make them, harvest them afterwards. Of course, both above ground, as you see here, and below ground, biomass is looked at. But if you get these images, you could do other, I mean, internode length and all these things that would be necessary. So this is really the phenotyping facility. So that's, indoor conditions. I should add, however, that we, of course, do other things as well. We do field phenotyping, and there we are much less advanced. And this is an experiment, picture down from not so far away from here in southern Halland, where we have a lot of transgenic trees out there. This particular site is over 100 different genotypes that have been over the years have planted out. And then we, of course, would like to see how they both in terms of growth, but also in terms of phenology. Here I must say we are still using people going out and measuring with sticks and other things. So it's a... and this is really the limitation. I myself involved in that. I'm also looking at natural variation. So there we have other fields with just natural aspen ecotypes. And this is a picture from one of our papers where we looked at, in this case, open senescent, but also bunset. Then we have the blue colors, that's where we have the common gardens. And of course, in reality, we need to have a person working there for 3 months. We need to employ someone going out there doing nothing but measuring trees. So this is the limitation here. We really think it would be so much better if we could make 10 common gardens. But this, then 10 projects. And so we will get there discussing this. But you see, there are things like, there are, if you work with trees, one thing is you need to treat everyone as an individual. That's the whole point. And there is a lot of genetic variation, so you can't do this on an average. You need to look at each and every tree. And it is a challenge, but I should stop by saying, mention something that we are not really involved in. But foresters and forestry are getting in one way really advanced when it comes to these things. They're extremely boring when it comes to phenotyping, because they only care about how big is the tree. And that's what foresters always do. They pay the diameter at breast width height, and then they have some equations to see how many cubic meters are in there. And that's what they've been doing for 100 years. But now, of course, they are getting, now you can get this app where you go out there and just trying to get all this information. But the other thing is the Swedish, however, but that's from Skogforsk, one of the previous report where they actually talk about that. Today, when the big machines are going out to do the
reality, you're getting close now to the system where they know exactly every tree which are cutting, where it's sitting. And this data is fed back and forth to databases, so it really can start helping the driver there to say, I will cut this tree from this tree. How thin should we do it? The selection this year, because it depends on kind of soil prep, soil characteristics and so on. So they are, in some aspects, they are more primitive. But in, I would say this is really looking at each and every tree. You can even imagine that in 20 years, if we keep on doing all these genome studies and so on, if we start in building databases so we know every tree in the forest, which is the parents of it, and how does this perform under these conditions and so on, and then you can start generating huge data sets that could be useful. And some of these techniques may be also something that could be similar to what you're doing. So, but with that, I think I should stop. We have questions now or later.
You can maybe save some of the questions for the panel.
Yeah.
Because I think there are similar things that will be discussed there. Thank you very much.